Good morning. Great to be here. So good to see everybody. Thank you so much. Excited about today's bill signing. And also, 79 years ago was the D-Day invasion. And I think we all owe those men a debt of gratitude for what they did for freedom that day. We're also excited to be leading the way in the state of Florida. We're working on finishing up the budget. The legislature passed it. I got to review everything. But the state of Florida, I think it's an interesting contrast. In Washington, they're adding trillions of more in debt. In Florida, we're running budget surpluses. We have the second lowest debt per capita ratio in the entire country. Our economy here is about $1.2 trillion. We'd be the 13th largest economy in the world if we were a separate country, just the state of Florida. And yet of $1.2 trillion economy, the debt is $17 billion. And compare that to federal, where the overall debt is much larger than our overall economy. In Florida, our state debt is just a small sliver, like a percent and a half of our overall economy. And so, you know, that's how you manage things well. We enacted $2.7 billion in tax relief this year. That's a state record by far. We set the record last year with $1.2 billion. Then we doubled that with $2.7 billion. So we're excited about the tax relief. We're also excited about we led yet again in in-migration 2022. I think we had 330,000 people move to Florida. I'm not asking people to move. I mean, like, look, we've got great people. But it's like, you know, they want to go where the action is. And so they're leaving some of these areas that are poorly governed, and they're coming here. And there's people all over the country looking to buy places in the villages. I can tell you that because I see them and they tell me about it. So we have that. Number one fastest growing, number one in new business formations, and I think we've been number one in new business formations every year since I've been governor. We also have the second lowest state per capita tax burden, which is a very, very important no income tax, and we're going to keep it that way. We're ranked number one now in education by U.S. News and World Report, which is exciting. Also number one for education freedom, and number one for parental involvement in education, which is very important. So we'll put the finishing touches on this budget very, very soon, but part of, I think, the reason we've been successful is we have had a good commitment to education. It helps with the economy. It helps, obviously, given individuals the ability to make the most of their own life, but it's not just trying to shovel everybody to a four-year brick and ivy university. We've done a lot to expand vocational and workforce education in the state of Florida. We've expanded apprenticeships, which is really, really important. And it's when you're trying to shove everyone for a university, look, there's good stuff at universities, but we all know that they also have degrees like zombie studies degrees, which are just not doing much for people. So if people are getting put into that, that's not really the best thing for them. And of course, it's not really optimal for our economy either. So I think we've really done affordable higher education, no tuition increases at our universities. We're now, I think we have the lowest in-state tuition. It's like $6,400, $6,200, depending on the university. Our out-of-state tuition at our state universities is actually lower than a lot of places' in-state tuition, if you can believe that. And we're proud of that. We want it to be affordable. You shouldn't have to mortgage your entire future just to get a college degree. So we're making that a reality in Florida. But we also are looking at our state colleges, looking to them to expand opportunities, workforce, and the high schools. And we're doing more this year with what the legislature did to get more vocational in high schools. They used to have this. That was like a standard thing. Then they went away from it. We want to make sure that's there. We want to make sure there's apprenticeships for high school and people at our state colleges. And that ultimately, I think, is going to bode well for Florida over the long haul. So we're excited about doing that. We're excited about getting this budget signed. Now, today, we are here to sign a piece of legislation called the Digital Bill of Rights. And I think we all know that if we looked at how our daily lives function today, versus how they did 25 years ago, you see radical differences in how that functions. Heck, my wife and I, we were out the other day talking about how we met. And when we met, it was 2006. There were no smartphones then. And so like I asked her to go out with me, but I didn't even have her number yet. So she was following me in her car. And I had no idea where I was going because I didn't have a map on the phone. It was just a flip phone then. And then finally I found a place, pulled over, and we met there, and the rest is history. But it's just, that is just, you know, in our lifetime, the idea that you would be able to just, you know, type in something on a device and it maps you where you want to go, that was not how it was for most of our lives. And so the technology, all these things are such a big part of our daily lives. And there's some benefits to that, but there are also some drawbacks to that. And I think we've seen with some of these big tech companies how they've used their power to advance their agenda, how they've used their power to commandeer personal information of individual Americans. And so we want to make sure that we're providing protection for Floridians to speak their mind on these platforms, making sure that their data isn't monetized without their consent, making sure that government is not colluding with these companies to try to stifle speech like we've seen in recent history. So we're tackling all those. Now, we did the big tech censorship bill in 2021. I think we may have signed that we did an event around it here. But basically, our 2021 law said things like Facebook, these are private companies, that's true, but they put themselves out as being open platforms. And they say, we're not publishers. You can use our platform and you can say, you know, what you want, basically. And they get liability protection from the federal government. You can't sue them if somebody goes on their platform and defames you because they say they're not making publishing decisions. But what we've seen over the years is they take that liability protection, they say they're not publishers, and then they put the thumb on the scale in favor of one perspective. And if you're offering conservative dissent, you could get stifled, you could get taken down. If you dissented from the COVID, official COVID orthodoxy, they would take you down, they would try to stifle you. And so that is taking, I think, liability protection and abusing it. So what our bill just said is, look, if you're an open platform, if that's how you're advertising, you can have rules in terms of what you want or not want, but you gotta apply those evenly. And if you're discriminating against people with viewpoints you don't like, then they have an ability to seek redress. And so we put that in, we gave the Attorney General the ability to bring actions against tech companies for unfair and deceptive trade practices. And we also prohibited big tech platforms from deplatforming political candidates. Now, they immediately sued on that, and we knew it was gonna be a huge legal issue. So this case, the law is now pending at the US Supreme Court. And I think that they're going to end up taking it probably for next year. But the question is just going to be, these big tech companies, are they able to just get liability protection and then just do whatever they want? Or if they're acting as publishers, do they lose the liability protection? And if that's the case, look, as a publisher, any one of you can set up a website and you could host only the views you want. No one's disputing that. What I think we're disputing is when they say it's an open platform, when they're getting this liability protection, you then sign up, they take your data and they make money off of it, and then they censor you if you say something they don't like. That wasn't the deal. And so we want to be able to hold accountable on that. So stay tuned on the tech censorship. But then, even since we passed the bill, the things that came out are even much worse than what we even thought then. We, of course, knew during COVID that they were censoring people who were speaking out against lockdowns, speaking out against mask mandates, speaking out against school closures. But what I think we learned in the intervening time is that this was not just tech doing it on their own. They were actually working with people like Fauci and working with people in the government. And so they were basically doing the government's bidding in terms of stifling dissent. You cannot, as a government, subcontract out restrictions of speech to a private company and say that's somehow okay. It's not okay. And so that basically is a violation of the First Amendment when they're acting as an arm of the state. And we saw that with COVID. We also saw it with the suppression of the Hunter Biden story in the 2020 election. That was FBI and DHS working with these companies. And basically, they were the ones spewing misinformation, and they were censoring truthful information. So the fusion of government and tech for the purpose of censoring things that dissent from the official narrative, that's a huge, huge threat to freedom of speech in this country. And so Florida's leaned in on that. This is going to be resolved by the Supreme Court on that particular censorship front. But then what we're doing here today, I think, is covering a lot more ground that we need to be able to protect the folks in our state. So I'm going to sign Senate Bill 262 today, and this does create the digital Bill of Rights. It basically establishes a number of protections for Floridians with respect to the digital sphere. One, the right to control your personal data, including the right to confirm access and delete your personal data from a social platform. You should be in control of this and ultimately have the final say over it. Also has the right to know that your personal data will not be used against you when purchasing a home, obtaining health insurance, or being hired. That's important for privacy. You also have a right to know how internet search engines manipulate search results. You know, if you go back and did a Google search 20 years ago and then did the same thing today, much different result. You know, big changes in algorithms, and I think these algorithms oftentimes have an agenda. And this will start tying into huge issues about things like artificial intelligence. You know, the artificial intelligence is basically mining data and doing things, but if that data is flawed, or if they're trying to produce an agenda with the underlying data, the outputs are going to be flawed as well. Big, big problem for society if that happens. That's not addressed in this bill because this is something that would need to be addressed federally, but there's huge, huge perils with some of the things that are going on in that realm as well. You also have the right to opt out of having your personal data sold. So when they do these platforms, you're signing up, they don't charge you for it, but they take your data and they sell it to all these vendors usually, and they make a lot of money selling your data. Well, you should have the right to say, no, you know, I don't want you selling my data. You now will with this book, with this bill. And then finally, this provides the right to protect children from personal data collection. Do you really want companies mining your child's data? Now you're going to have protection against it. One of the things this does that I think is important is it includes biometric data and geolocation information adding that to the definition of personal data. Because if you think about it, they can track, you know, you have a phone, they can track where you're going on your phone. So if you go from here and you go 2 miles down the street to like a McDonald's, they will have that data. And that's really about personal data for you. So we're counting that as personal in terms of things that you have a right to privacy to, because we don't want tech companies being able to willy-nilly track your day-to-day movements. It's just not right. What we're going to do with the search engines is require Google and other large search engines operating in Florida to disclose whether they prioritize search results based on political or ideological views or based on monetary considerations. So much of it is you type in these searches, what they generate has a huge influence on how people see the world. So what's the agenda that's leading into that? Another important provision on this bill, in Florida, this bill will ban all state and local government officials from coordinating with big tech to police or to censor protected speech. We're not going to be in a situation where you have like the FBI colluding with Facebook and then they're censoring stories that are truthful because it doesn't fit the agenda. So our government agents, and we have not done that in Florida, and I don't think any local officials have been doing that to my knowledge, but the reality is now there's protections against that. It is inappropriate for government agents to be working with platforms to try to infringe on people's speech rights. And so now that'll be the law in Florida. And then yes, of course, with the children, you know, this is gonna ensure that online platforms that are providing services, games, or products targeted to children will not collect, sell, or share the personal data of a child. It's very difficult with kids, because like our kids, 6, 5, and 3, you know, they'll grab our phones and they'll just start typing stuff in. And you know, they know how to do this stuff very quickly. It's something that they learn. And so, you know, are they gonna be like downloading this or that? And so it's, I think a lot of parents are concerned about how some of this stuff is operating. So all in all, this is a very robust series of protections for Floridians. I think it's going to make a big difference, and I think I'm really proud that the legislature was able to get this done. We had been working on this really for the last year or two, and we just had too many hurdles, I think, with the legislature at that time on kind of getting it right. Because on the one hand, you know, we want to protect your rights to data and privacy. On the other hand, you know, we don't want necessarily this to generate, you know, frivolous lawsuits or things like that. So you needed to find the happy medium. And I think we were able to do it today. So this empowers Floridians. You are not just going to be at the mercy of Big Brother kind of looking over everything you do and collecting all the information about you without your consent. And so I hope people will avail themselves of these protections, and I think it'll make a positive difference for freedom in the state of Florida. We're going to hear from some people before I sign the bill, so I'm going to call each one of them up, and then we'll put the John Hancock on the piece of legislation. So first we're going to hear from Monty Floyd, a Hernando County father of four.
Good morning, everyone. As a father of four in this day and age, I can tell you that it's not easy protecting our children from the never-ending assaults by various entities, namely corporations, to push their agenda and spy on our families. It has become a game in my household where my wife and I will now talk about various items around our smart devices to see if the advertisements will appear about what we just discussed. This is why we heavily restrict our children's access to the internet and online applications, let alone the media. We do so to protect our children's privacy, their innocence, and their personal safety, to shield them from exploitation and manipulation by aggressive marketing tactics, which almost always involve an agenda that conflicts with our family's values and what we feel is appropriate for our children. Take the month of June, for instance. I'm sure that my wife and I are not alone in having to play parental goaltender throughout this entire month. It's not easy being a parent in this age, but June really ups the difficulty to an entirely new level. Companies who are only looking out for their profits use sophisticated algorithms to target vulnerable people, such as our children, and then proceed to exploit that vulnerability through aggressive and targeted methods by utilizing a glaring loophole in the 1998 Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, by claiming not to know who the users are or how old the users are, while crafting systems to prey on children. The Washington Post recently published a story about how smartphones and applications are not only harvesting our personal data, but are very engaged in collecting the data of our children on a scale that would shock many in this room. According to this article, by the time a child is 13, online advertising firms collect on average 72 million data points per child. In this day and age, most parents have become aware of this and the agenda that's behind it. But what many don't understand is how our public school system is also engaged in this nefarious activity and is exploiting our children and their data in the same exact manner that big tech does. In my county of Hernando, our school district is infested with a slew of educational technology and digital handouts, some of which were blindly rushed out in the wake of COVID-19, to the point that our district offered every student a laptop and has even begun the process of installing Wi-Fi on school buses. We even had the student data and privacy of a school board member's child leaked out and plastered all over social media. School districts and their many educational technology providers use data mining techniques to collect and sell students' data to the highest bidder so that companies can better target our students with personalized and often agenda-driven advertisements and content. The weaponization of our children's private data can lead to exploitation by educational technology companies or outside groups who then take this private data so that they can better manipulate our children's preferences and behavior by encouraging addictions to certain products or pressuring them to conform to targeted social expectations. This Senate bill is a great step towards curtailing that exploitation and shutting it down, as well as protecting the data of our children. Thank you, Governor DeSantis and our Florida legislators, for continuing to safeguard the privacy and well-being of our children right here in Florida. Thank you.
Okay, we have Larry John right here from the Villages.
Good morning, and it's a pleasure to be here. I actually read this bill, and I was actually going to comment on it a little bit, but the governor's done a pretty good job, and I don't want to repeat what he's said. Well, I used to be a judge before I moved here, and the words that I hated most was, "Your Honor, I'm going to be brief," because that never happened. But so I'm just going to truncate my comments a little bit here. I do want to tell you a little bit about how I got involved in an organization called Seniors Versus Crime, and just mention some of the things that we do. But I'm 73 years old. My wife Carol and I moved to the Villages about 2 years ago, and yes, indeed, we grew up in an era where we knew our local butcher and grocerman and all of the merchants that we dealt with face to face. And then in the 80s and 90s, we got this thing called the internet. And we didn't realize that for the last 40 years or so, people have been collecting data and putting it somewhere in a huge database and using it sometimes, as the governor said, to our advantage, but very often to our detriment. So this bill, I think, is going to help us to do that. I do want to tell you about my story. As I said, I was a judge before I came here for about 16 years in the state of Iowa, and was an attorney for about 40 years. And my wife owned a small business in Ames, Iowa, and I thought I was a fairly sophisticated person and didn't need a lot of protection from other people. But it wasn't long after we bought our home, we did what a lot of people in the Villages do. We start putting improvements in, contacting various contractors and merchants. And it wasn't too long before a young woman came to our house. And by the way, this was during COVID, so we were very frustrated in that it took a long time to get anybody to come out and do your new countertops. You'd go and they'd say, "Well, we'll see you in about a year." And so we were desperate to find people. So we found a young woman to do our solar shades on our lanai, and we invited her to our house. She did a lot of measurements, showed us samples and things, and said that'll be $4,300. And we said, "Oh, well, I guess that's a pretty good deal." And she wanted $2,300 in cash up front, which of course we gave to her, and that's about the last we ever saw of her. And so I went to an organization here in the Villages called, and it's not just in the Villages, but it's called Seniors Versus Crime, and so I didn't know who to turn to. So they hooked me up with an investigator. They said, "Oh yeah, we know this person. She has victimized several other people in the Villages and got away with their money." And they helped me to try and get my money back, to eventually put me in touch with the Sumter County Sheriff's Office, who did a thorough investigation. Of course, she had flown the coop by now, and we didn't know where she was, but they tracked her down and worked with the local prosecutors to prosecute her, and she did a short amount of time in jail and is now on probation. And yesterday I cashed my first check for restitution. So I'm not asking you to feel sorry for me, but what I'm saying is we are a member of the baby boom generation, those of you, many of you that live in the Villages here, and we are a demographic group that is subject to, well, first of all, we have a little bit of money, we trust people, and we want to get things done. And we are a group that is very subject to being victimized and taken advantage of. So the group that I work with, Seniors Versus Crime, is a special project of the Florida Attorney General's Office, excuse me for going back to Iowa. And we have 31 offices throughout Florida. I am a volunteer and I don't work every day, just work occasionally. But we have many, many volunteers. I think they put in about 40,000 hours per year volunteering to assist people. And there's no fee for our services. We try to help folks who have been victimized. And one of the reasons they're victimized is because they put information about themselves out for public consumption. They go on the on Facebook and tell everybody what their profile is. They shop for things, and so everybody knows where what their tastes are. As the governor said, they can track us. They know exactly where we are, whether we're visiting our relatives, and they know a lot about us. And I've heard many, many scams since I've been here as a result of people mining data, focusing on people who are vulnerable, misrepresenting themselves as agents of the IRS or agents of the sheriff's office or people who want you to bail their grandson out of jail. And so that's something that we try to help with, and it's something that I think this bill will help tremendously with. So long as people know about it and use it and get familiar with its provisions. I've read the bill. I haven't studied it in great length. I've learned a lot about it just sitting here today. But I do plan to use it with my clients and people that I work with and help to educate them about this. And I do want to thank the legislature and the governor for having worked so hard to bring this to us. I'm not a person that likes a lot of regulation in my life, but for about 40 years, the internet has been basically unregulated. And we wouldn't need regulations if there weren't people out there trying to scam us, but there are. And so I see that this is necessary legislation. And I'm very grateful to the governor and the legislature for having done this and for giving me an opportunity to speak to you today. Thank you.
Okay, Representative Fiona McFarlane.
I'm so pleased that someone read the bill because it's quite long. And as the House sponsor of this bill, I want to tell you guys how important this bill is. We started working on this in 2019. It's been the priority of the governor. It's been the priority of two consecutive Speaker of the Houses, starting under the leadership of Chris Browles and continuing this session with Speaker Paul Renner. And it's taken us this long to get this bill right because every company out there knows the most important thing they have is our data. It is more valuable than gold at this point. And here's what this bill will do for Floridians, because Floridians know this too. This bill will give Floridians the ability to know what information big tech companies are collecting about them. It's going to give Floridians the ability to ask them to delete it and get rid of it if they don't want them to have it anymore. And it's going to give Floridians the right to opt out of their information being sold or shared to the highest bidder for profit, unless you give them permission to. This is huge, folks. We all know, Larry's talked about it, the governor's talked about it, we've talked about it, the impact of our children. There is so much data out there about us. These big tech companies know our every thought, our behavior, the next step we're going to take, whether we're going to turn left or right at a traffic light. And Floridians are creeped out by how much data is out there. We're not really sure what they're doing with it, and that doesn't matter. This bill is gonna give each of us the ability to decide whether we're comfortable with that or not comfortable with that. It's on us now. This bill will give that important digital bill of rights and the transparency about what is happening with our private data online. And we're gonna go one step further when it comes to the children of Florida. We're gonna say, to any social media company out there, any company where children are regularly interacting with online content, and we're going to say if that content is harmful to a child under the age of 18, whether it's exposing them to sexually explicit material, bullying behavior, drugs, paraphernalia, or even creating these harmful algorithms that are targeting on the developing great brain chemistry of a young child to promote, you know, difficult self-images and mental health, set them up for mental health disorders down the road, we're gonna say, in Florida, you cut it out. We got our eye on you. Thank you so much to the governor for having leadership to drive this bill, to combat the evils of big tech, and give Floridians really, really important protections when it comes to our personal information online.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to come up here and we'll make it official with signing in the law. All right, guys, we'll be back soon. Thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.